Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to talk about a classical problem from antiquity of trisecting an angle. Trisecting a segment is easy with ruler and compass. You go three steps in some other direction, draw parallels, and then you automatically divide your given segment into three pieces. That works equally well for 5 or 7 or any other number of segments you want to divide something equally. However, dividing angles into 3 or 5 or 7 equal angles is much harder, and with Euclidean constructions it's impossible, as we now know. Here's the corresponding problem for bisectors, which is possible. L1 and L2 are two lines. Choose two points here, open our compass, draw those little arcs, that's a bisector. If we had chosen those two points to start with, compass here, equal compass there, then we get another bisector in that direction. So these two lines have two equal and perpendicular bisectors. The problem for trisectors is a little bit more subtle. If we're going from L1 to L2, there are three possible trisectors. They are right there, the three red lines. So for example, to go from here to here, if we do that once more and then once again, we get to L2. Or if we go from here to here and then we go once again and then once more, we get to L2. And similarly from here to here, once more, and once more. So there are three trisectors from L1 to L2. Correspondingly, another three from L2 to L1. When we consider this problem from a rational trigonometry point of view, which is the right way of thinking about things, then we work with spreads instead of angles. So here's a situation. We have lines L1, L2, L3, L4, and they're each separated by a spread of S. Then we know that the spread between L1 and L3 is given by this expression, 4 times S times 1 minus S. That's the second spread polynomial. While the relationship between L1 and L4 is given by S times 3 minus 4S all squared, that's the third spread polynomial. These two are crucial in discussing the questions of trisection or bisection of lines. All right, one way to approach this trisection problem is to consider triangles in which the three spreads are related by S, S2 of S, and S3 of S. So S1, S2, S3, the three spreads, suppose that they're equal to S, 4S times 1 minus S, and S times 3 minus 4S all squared, respectively. Then a lovely theorem of Frank Hadley asserts that that relationship holds between the three spreads precisely when the three quadrances of the triangle satisfy this simple little relation. Q2 minus Q1 all squared equals Q1 times Q3. Frank Hadley is a retired architect from Bronte Beach who discovered this lovely result, and I thank Graham Greenup for telling me about Frank's work. So let's sketch a proof. So there's two directions. So suppose, first of all, that the three spreads of the triangle satisfy that relation. Then here are the relations between the three spreads, the proportion, S1, S2, to S3. According to the spread law, that's got to be equal to the proportion between the three quadrances. Now there's a common factor of S here, so we can cancel that common factor. So we get this to this to this is still the relation between the three quadrances. And now we observe that this second quantity minus the first quantity all squared is just the third quantity, or which we can write as 1 times the third quantity. So that relation is this minus this all squared equals this times this. That means that this corresponding relationship holds over here. Q2 minus Q1 all squared equals Q1 times Q3. And that's the relationship that we wanted to derive. In the other direction, in the converse direction, we suppose that we have this relationship between the three quadrances, and we want to try to prove that the three spreads have that required relation. First of all, we use the spread law to realize that the three spreads satisfy the same relation. S2 minus S1 squared equals S1 times S3. From which we can deduce that S3 is S2 minus S1 squared over S1. The three spreads of the triangle have to satisfy the triple spread formula. So when we plug that value S3 into here, we get a new formula only involving S1 and S2. And when we factor that, we get three factors. S2 minus S1, which can never be 0, because if it was, then S3 would be 0. S2 can't be 0. And so this quantity must be 0, telling us that S2 has to be 4 times S1 times 1 minus S1. And then if we know S1 and S2, we can solve for S3, because it's given by this. S3 then turns out to be the third spread polynomial. That's a proof of both directions of Hadley's theorem. And now we're going to see how Hadley's triangle naturally connects with the trisectrix from ancient Greek geometry. So here ABC is a Hadley triangle, which means that the spread here is S, the spread here is S2 of S, and the spread here is S3 of S. If AB is fixed and C is allowed to vary, then it moves or traces out this classical curve called a trisectrix. This trisectrix can be constructed in the following way. If you take the circle whose center is at A, on which B lies, so there's its radius, and draw an arbitrary line from B through the circle at E, then on each side of E you lay out an equal radius to the circle, giving F and D. Then as E varies, D and F will trace out the two arcs of the trisectrix. So here's how we can use the trisectrix to solve the trisection problem. Take this spread here. That line intersects the trisectrix in three points, here, here, and here. And then each of those three points determines a triangle, which is a Hadley triangle, so that the spread up here at the C point will be in the relation S to S3 of S. So that one there is trisecting that spread there. Describing curves like the trisectrix is really helped by going outside the usual Cartesian coordinate system. So next time I'm going to tell you about polar coordinates from a rational geometry point of view. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.